Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Beautiful day here in Ballarat. and we're inside, but still, it's going to be good in here too. Beethoven's Prometheus. It was written in 1800. It was in his early part of his life, his musical life. It was just before the famous Heiligenstadt Testament, where he was realised he was going deaf. So it's just before he was being deaf. It starts very dramatic, real Beethoven sort of thing. There's this lovely organic woodwind section, and then it goes seamlessly into a lovely allegro that really bubbles along, and the orchestra join in with a real rejoicing.
Thank you.
by Brahms. He took elements from his fifth symphony, which he didn't write, and put it into this piece. When I was first studying the cello years ago at high school, I remember hearing about this Brahms, playing this sonata by Brahms, thinking, oh, I really like this. It had these lovely long lines and things, as this piece does. And I went into a record shop and I thought, I must try listening to some other Brahms. And I picked this LP of Second Piano Concerto and I stuck it on and I put headphones on. It's the first time in my life I ever listened to music with headphones. And within 10 seconds, I had a lovely horn opening. And the tears were just coming out. I thought, oh my goodness me. I looked for a place to hide in the record shop. It just had that effect. Music is a really amazing thing, how it can sort of get in through the cracks, so to speak, right deep inside. Brahms has big phrases. And this piece is quite complicated. There's often twos against threes, plus syncopation, plus a bit of elastic rubato, if you like, a bit of flexibility. So it's quite difficult to bring off. And it's not often done because I think it requires two soloists. Anyway, we're lucky to have the two soloists we have today, and we shall begin. It's one of those days, I think.
Thank you.
Just a brief word, this piece by Offenbach was the first piece I consciously remember asking my father to put the record on again. I used to listen to it. It was an LP and it had a picture of a horse on the front. And I'd say, can you please put the horsey record on, please? I love it because it's got sparkle, it's got contrast, it's got lovely legato lines, and he brings in this new angular theme by having a bar of this and a bar of angular and a bar of legato, and then he does this wonderful transition.
Thank you.
probably know Bizet for his most famous piece, the opera Carmen. This is La Lusienne Suite. Beautiful piece of music. The first piece is a farandole. It's wonderful. It starts off with a full orchestra, and there's a variation for cello. I think of cellos, but of course it's horns involved as well, and bassoons as well. Bassoons are going. It's a lovely little accompaniment. There's all these things going on together. Later on, there's a famous piece called Carillon, which is bells. And then there's a slow 6/8 section, and then you hear the bells coming back in a different rhythm. And then it's like he's testing it out, and he changes the speed back to the normal speed very quietly, and then, yes, we've got it again. And then it comes back with a rejoicing ending. Also in this piece is a wonderful saxophone. It's almost like a little saxophone concerto. It's not very long. Saxophone is a very unusual instrument to be in an orchestra, but I think it has a special quality, and maybe it should be more in orchestras. It represents a person who is a rather simple person. Maybe, sorry. Sorry, I didn't mean it like that. Maybe because of its special tonal qualities, and maybe a simple person, often they're not actually heard. Maybe sometimes the interface between communication and what's really going on inside them isn't accessible to people. And I think this is a wonderful opportunity it's just marvellous the way he wrote it, like a real out there solo. Anyway, La Lusienne.
Thank you.
often talk in rehearsals, you know, it seems sort of simple, you know. When you start music, learning music, you learn to keep time. And then when things get really interesting, then you learn to bend the time around a bit, to a little bit longer on that note, a little bit shorter on that note. The trouble is, when a whole orchestra does that, it's like potentially a minefield. Because you've got to prioritise what you're seeing from the conductor, what you're hearing from musicians, and thinking about the phrasing and where you fit in and your relative importance of your line. So it may sound as if, you know, oh, it's just rocking along, and that should be the impression you get is one of ease. But actually, inside their minds, there's a serious lot going on. Is that right? There should be, anyway. This is a lovely overture, William Tell. You probably all know the Lone Ranger, you know. That's the bit at the end. The bit people don't often know about is the gorgeous cello opening. It's fantastic. Then there's a storm. In this gorgeous cello opening, you can hear the timpani going a little bit like, whoa, there's a storm in the distance, you know. And then later on it comes, and then you hear the raindrops going in the woodwind. Okay, and then it gets bigger and bigger, and then wah, it really gets going, and that's when the trombones really get going. Richard Strauss, the famous composer, he said, "Never look encouragingly at the trombones." Because when they get going, it's such a powerful, magnificent instrument, it can be dominating at times. Anyhow, that happens, and that's it. Then at the end, there's a bit you all know.
Thank you. Thank you.